G'day everyone and welcome to episode 146 of the Trademate Sports Betting Podcast. As you can see, I'm joined once again by professional sports bettor Neel Shah. Welcome to the podcast, mate.
Nice to be back. Sorry you couldn't get anyone decent this time again. So yeah. Filling in, super sub, Ollie.
No, mate, it's been a long time since we've done a little episode here. I've been very, very slack, taking a little bit of a sabbatical, but it's beautiful to be back, mate, and I couldn't think of anyone better than yourself to get back on the podcast. It's an honor and a pleasure, mate. It's probably been 6 months probably since the last,
episode. Has it been that long? I suppose it has.
It's been a while. So what's been happening, mate?
Much the same really. Just kind of grinding away. Trying to refine a few things I'm doing. Just recently, sort of this week, I've started a kind of a tipster group. So again, it's kind of trying to share, most of my selections. Kind of for people to get an insight of. The kind of bets that I'm doing, a little bit of education thrown in here or there, and a nice little community, lots of other kind of smart people in there, sharing what they're doing. So I'm enjoying that. That's it at the moment. And then hopefully, starting a role soon, that's quite exciting. And trying to see what I can do. And just, I think now I've been doing it a while. Kind of moving away from a high volume approach, and I think trying to be a little bit more selective and more efficient with my time, and that's definitely been helpful and something reduce the stress and reduce my hours somewhat as well. So that's I suppose part of the evolution of the journey. But I think things are going all right. How about you?
Yeah, very good, mate. I was going to ask, are we gonna reveal this new role? You're very, very. You weren't really revealing much there. Are we gonna do a grand reveal, or are we keeping it a secret?
No, we'll see. Maybe further down the line. I want to see first,
okay.
It was a disaster, and I don't last the first day. Then rather not say now.
and you said becoming more selective in your process. Do you think that's Is that because you've built your bankroll to a certain point now where it's not just about you can have fewer bets and still essentially turn over the exact same amount of money?
It's a combination. So for some things, because I kind of set up separate banks for different things. So a few things that have gone quite well, so I can be a bit more selective. But it's also about marginal gains, really. So I think kind of, for example, sort of this year, so January and February were sort of a bit of a disaster. So I kind of took a step back and kind of, looked at everything I was doing and thought, fine, I'm finding value here, I'm finding EV here, but for the amount of time that it's taking me to do it, is it actually worth it? How much more is it contributing? How much more profit is it actually going to make? So I think part of that is, sort of filtering things down, kind of cross-referencing things, and sort of going into more depth with a few things. So, again, trying to focus a bit more on developing my own models. So really sort of shifting the focus from, where can I be making more profit to kind of, let me improve what I have, let me sort of reduce the time I'm spending, the kind of crazy hours I've been doing lately, and kind of thought before I burn out again, let me kind of pause, reset and try to manage it really. So combination of that, but the main reason definitely it wasn't necessarily a bankroll, it's just about kind of quality over quantity. And again, long term, I just think it's just, for me personally, just wouldn't have been sustainable to kind of do what I was doing without having some kind of breakdown. So I think that's kind of the main thing. It's kind of more of a quality of life
decision. Man.
Yeah.
I like that. I like that. And I think one of the things that we talked about 6 months ago, which I think we had a really good conversation about, was how you'd stopped tracking your bets. Do you, like, during that tough period of January and February, I think I mentioned 6 months ago that I couldn't not track my bets, because if I was going through a bad couple of months, I'd need to, like, look at where I'm going wrong, because I have terrible biases in my brain that tell me this is going well, that's not going well. And then when I look at the numbers, I'm like, oh, fuck, it's actually the other way around. So how did you get through that 2 months and kind of pick and choose what was doing well, what was going bad, if you hadn't tracked any of your bets?
Well, yeah, no, just to clarify, so the things are tracked, but not sort of meticulously for every single bet. So, for example, you know, let's say I've had 20 bets that day in a few bookie shops. I'll have the figures, you know, from that day. And generally, sort of the edge is fairly similar, you know, with the things I'm putting in there. So, you know, I was kind of more looking at the kind of P&L, you know, based on sort of how many points, what I'm staking per point. So there's a general idea that,
okay,
you know, this is kind of how it's gone. And, you know, this was, again, the figures from week 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So that was kind of aggregated. But in terms of, yeah, drilling into sort of specifics of each one, that hasn't been done. But I think now, again, with the group that I've set up, to be honest, one of the big reasons is, again, just to kind of, to have a motivation to track it meticulously, because again, sometimes it's just like, well, why am I doing this? You know, why am I tracking every single thing? What sort of benefit is there to the process? It's taking up so much admin time. But I think now that I've kind of reduced the volume, it's a lot easier just to kind of track things. Again, you know, sort of track the specifics, track the closing lines, or if the lines move. And do that, you know, again, because if there's kind of potentially 50, 60, 100 bets in a day, you know, it's just not impossible, but it just takes a lot of time. So I think that shift away has definitely helped. So, you know, that's something going forward I will be, you know, doing more specific tracking, again, going back over bets in more detail. Something you can, you know, you can really benefit from.
Yeah, cool. Nice to hear, mate. And myself, I will finally answer your question, which you asked about 10 minutes ago. yeah, I mean, I've just been, you know, going along. It's been about 6 months since finished up with Trademate. So been just living the life of a pro sports bettor, essentially. Like, lots, trying a few different things, trying to, I think the last month or two, just trying to hone in on the things that are going really well, or, you know, going well, or at least what places where I can see there's an edge, and trying to, I think, similar to what you said before, allocate bigger or smaller bankrolls to certain things. So if there's, you know, something where I'm not too sure if there is an edge there, or the edge is smaller, then putting less money into that, less turnover, and putting bigger amounts of money on the things that I know have much bigger ROIs. So, yeah, I guess just going through the journey, as you met, as like yourself, started up the MMA Tipster channel with Punt School about 6 months ago, and that's been going pretty well. Lots of ups and downs.
I'm a subscriber.
Thank you, mate. So that's been an interesting journey, very interesting journey. So, I mean, most of my weeks is just, most of my week is spent watching tape on the UFC fights for the weekend, coming up with bets for that and for my channel. So, yeah, mate, it's been always learning new stuff every week. Once you immerse yourself in betting and it becomes your full-time job, and you're putting money on everything, and you're not just, you know, sitting back as a part-time or a hobby or whatever, your learnings are far more significant. So it's been a fun, well, I wouldn't say a very fun 6 months, but it's been, if you want to learn lots, and if you want to be emotionally stressed at certain points, then I highly recommend becoming a professional sportsman. If you enjoy stress.
For more stress in their life, this is the profession for them.
Yeah, 100%. But like I said, mate, we're going to talk. Well, we might as well just kick things off. If you are watching the video, you will have seen, and maybe you would have seen a little bit of promotion on Twitter. We're going to talk about two topics today, mainly. One, I guess both of us have become tipsters in the last 6 months, or for you, a week. But you've done it in the past too. You've done it in the past throughout the Euros and stuff like that. So I think that's a good place to start. There's probably people out there listening that have once thought about becoming a tipster or, you know, whatever. I think we can provide some kind of insight into what it's like, whether it's worth it, blah, blah, blah. And then after that, we're going to talk about opening new bookmaker accounts, which is something that you've invested a lot of time into lately, and kind of the pros and cons of that, or not the pros and cons of opening new accounts, but I guess things to look out for, things to help you get more longevity out of your accounts. I guess we've talked a lot about priming already, but I think, you know, what you've been doing is kind of getting a little bit more technical, you might say, going past the, you know, whatever, we'll get into it. But let's start off with becoming a tipster. We can both share our insights on this, but why did you want to start up a channel? At the moment, it's free. I don't know if that's your plan long term, but why would you want to become a tipster, and what is there to gain for you?
Yeah, it's a strange one. In the same way, this kind of life is recommended people who need more stress in their life. So, you know, again, sort of being a tipster, if you feel like you haven't got enough, you know, abuse in your life, or you know, grief, then this could be the profession for you as well. You know, being totally transparent about it, everyone will have different reasons, and I'm sure, you know, it'll be good to hear, you know, why you wanted to launch your tips as well. So for me it's it's sharpening my edge. I know that seems like a sort of strange answer, or, you know, maybe it's a bullshit answer, but genuinely, sort of putting your selections out there. I see sort of gambling Twitter is, there are some, you know, really smart people there. There's some excellent sort of free resources and lots of stuff, like obviously the Trademate podcast and all the stuff you put out there, and, you know, and similar stuff. But there's a lot of crap as well, and there's a lot of bad advice, and there's a lot of sort of marketing hype around people. You know, I don't want to be unkind, I don't want to call people out, but I've seen lots of stuff where I just think, you know, it's just either misleading, you know, or potentially dangerous, you know, to people who will get kind of sucked into this and kind of almost preying on problem gamblers and sort of promising false riches. And I think, you know, I'd seen a fair bit of that, and I kind of got to the point where I thought I was a bit fed up of it. And I suppose the other thing was, yeah, you know, maybe I should sort of put my money where my mouth is, and actually, let's just, you know, post some things up. Let's see if there's an interest for it. See if I help some people along the way. You know, as we'll discuss, you know, it's not, you know, being a tipster is not a kind of fast route to getting quick cash and easy money. There's easier ways than running a tipping group. Those were kind of the main reasons, and thought, you know, who knows, in the future, maybe it develops into something. And if it doesn't, at least I've basically got a little track record. So if I wanted to sort of develop some content or work with certain clients, do some more freelance work, then I can say, look, you know, I was, you know, tipping for a while, it went well. Or, you know, people can see the reasoning for my selections or write-ups, and you can kind of build connections. So there's always people, you know, in groups like this who have an interesting history themselves, or, you know, they think sort of varying levels of experience, and So it's another way to share connections and share contacts. And yeah, so someone accused me that of this is the reason I did this was to feed my own ego. And there probably is an element of truth to that. You know, you just, I suppose in a way, yeah, you know, if you're...
There are better ways to feed your ego. I can promise you that.
Yeah, probably. But yeah, you know, but there is an element of that. It's kind of, there's more to lose than there is to gain.
100%.
But in a strange kind of way, that's the appeal of it because, you know, I don't want to lose anyone any money, but at the same time, I'm just doing what I'm doing. And, you know, and I'm quite happy that long term, you know, most of it works. There needs to be refinements along the way. At least it works for now. And yeah, just if there's more people who, you know, who benefit from it, get some help from it, you know, further down the line, if it's any good, if I can get a bit of pocket money from, you know, people paying a few subs, why not? If it's stuff that I'm already doing, and it's not going to take me much longer to do, I think that's the key part is, you know, how long does it take you to, would it take you? So if you're interested in being a tipster, you know, does it occupy a lot of your time? But for me, I thought, you know, the way I'm going to do it, I'm just going to kind of, you know, post stuff up there and just kind of see how it goes. And yeah, so we'll see. It's gone pretty crap the first week. We're at a loss, but you know, it's there's plenty of time to turn it around. So yeah, it's interesting, I think. But the key thing is definitely it's sharpening my my reasoning and sort of giving, I suppose, when you're looking through selections, you do your research, you kind of have your criteria you look for, but then this kind of final piece of the puzzle would be, okay, look, it's one thing if you're going to bet on this yourself, if you're going to send that selection to a number of people who are also going to bet on it, it's that kind of extra, you know, little icing on the cake where you really think, okay, have I really considered it? You know, am I really happy with it? Am I willing for lots of people to put their money on it? And I think that's a kind of healthy pressure, which I think is quite good. I mean, yeah. What about for yourself? Like now, you've been doing it a while now, so I suppose you've had a look through things. You've refined a couple of things along the way as well.
Yeah, well, I mean, in terms of why I became a tipster, I guess it was like I'm going to be spending 20-30 hours a week watching fights and coming up with bets. That in terms of my bankroll and how much I can bet on these fights without succumbing, you know, I'm not going to go bet 10% of my bankroll on one fight just because I have an edge there. But you know, variance, if you've ever heard of it before, it's an absolute bitch. So it's like I'm not going to just go all in on certain bets just because I've been researching it all week. I'm still going to stick to the principles of like my max bet would be absolute max bet, which I barely ever do, would be 2% of my bankroll. So considering I'm only able to turn over, you know, low four figures on this stuff every weekend, like and investing 20 to 30 hours into that every week to find these bets, it's not really worth my time at all. So my thought was, well, why not supplement that, you know, time you're putting into making more money from sending the bets out to other people too. And also we know how, you know, volatile betting is. Why not give yourself some kind of guaranteed income that I'm going to get every single month, whatever, from the channel? And I think you know, when I explain it that way, it sounds like a grand idea, doesn't it? It sounds like it sounds like a very smart way to go about your business. But the problem is you know, I'm not exactly the most well-known person in the betting industry, and just because, you know, been doing a podcast for whatever 2 years or whatever, it doesn't mean that as soon as you start that everyone's going to flood in and start subscribing to your stuff. And early on, even if you are doing very well or very poorly, it doesn't matter. People aren't just gonna, you know, people aren't just gonna flood in and start paying you money for your stuff. You really need to have a huge following. And I mean like huge following. Like, you know, I don't think 5,000 followers on Twitter is gonna do it. Like I think you need tens of thousands to make this worth, to make it worth your time, because at the moment it is not worth my time at all, and it's never been worth my time to be honest for this whole 6 months. When you factor in the admin, when you factor in, I think most of all, the emotional stress of losing at times, and you know, like we've said a million times, the emotional toll of losing far outweighs the emotional toll of winning. So, yeah, personally, if I was advising myself 6 months ago whether to do this or not, I'd probably say no. But at the same time, I've learned so much in the last 6 months that it's helped me out anyway. So yeah, it's like, it's a pretty hard decision, or at least a hard question to pose for myself, but you know, learnt a lot. But at the end of the day, for I would say 99% of people, it's not going to live up to what you hope it to be. Probably, I think the way to do it is to, you know, in an ideal circumstance, is to build up some kind of following over years and years of doing content, or, you know, however you want to get your name out there, however you build up a following. And then once you see that there's like hundreds of people, thousands maybe, that listen to you every week, that rely on you, blah, 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 then I think maybe that's a decent time to do it. But at the moment, I do not make enough money from this. I make a lot more money from betting than I do this. So it's really not worth my time at the moment.
But would you say, like, does it take you, like, let's say the admin and everything else, does it take more time than you thought it would, like, in the beginning? So, like, does it eat up more time than you thought?
Probably, because you think, you know, I'll just send out every bet that I place, essentially. But then you have to factor in, you know, I just want to do everything perfectly. You know, I don't want to half-ass it. So every time I send out a bet, I want to go and look at every single bookmaker in Australia. We don't have any odds comparison sites. If there is any, you would be saving my life. There probably is some, but not for UFC at least. And then, you know, go through the odds comparison. So it's like Odds Checker, Best Fight Odds in America. It takes a lot of time just to find the odds for everything. Just to, like, I want to save everyone the time of going out and looking themselves. So once you factor that in, you know, on the day of the fights, like, I want to make sure I get all the closing prices for certain things. So log into all the sharp bookies and see what all the closing prices are for everything. And then, yeah, you add in the emotional toll, which I think is the main, but honestly, the admins, you know,
yeah,
it's fine. It really is fine. It's only the looking at prices for all the different bookies that's quite frustrating at times, but, yeah, it's the emotional toll that gets you, I reckon. That makes it not worth it.
Yeah, I think, so if there's any software engineers or developers listen to this, just give Alex a shout, make his life easier. See if you can program a bot, because, you know, that'll be like episode 147 is like teaching you how to make a virtual machine. I think that's what we decided, haven't we?
Well, I tried getting someone from Upwork, if anyone, it's like a freelance website for people that don't know, to make me a little, what do you call a scraper, to get all the odds from certain bookmakers, but he was useless. And yeah, maybe I could have found someone a bit better, but it didn't work out very well. But yeah, how are you finding your first week, mate, of doing it? And I mean, you're a little bit different because people aren't paying you, so maybe that takes a little bit of stress off you. And to be honest, like, I charge fuck all, so it's probably not much of a difference at all. But yeah, how are you finding the first week, and are you enjoying it at all?
Yeah, it's interesting you say that, because and to be honest, you do charge a very modest fee considering the work you put in, considering that it is quite a niche. There aren't many doing it, and there's plenty of bookers you can do, and generally also that the prices tend to hold as well. So, but I think there's a mentality around tipping which kind of relates to what you've said about pricing things and giving away for free. There's a lot of free tipsters out there. I would definitely say that the UK market is like, it's saturated with tipsters. So you've got to offer something different, especially if you've got paid service, it needs to be something different. You need to have a good track record, or you need to be incredibly good at marketing, because there are some shit groups. I'm not going to say crap, they're just shit, but people have been kind of hoodwinked into signing up to them and paying a fortune. I was recommended a group that I was in last month. I don't know if anyone from there is going to listen to this, but way overpriced for what it is. People in there are making money, but they're smashing through three or four, some days, three or four 365 accounts in a day, just arbing horses and fair enough. But they, all the stuff they're getting is from other websites. There's no origination going on. There's no write-ups. They see it as a waste of time. And that's another thing, So again, I spoke to a very well-known friend of the show on the weekend, but I don't want to name him just in case. He pointed out some quite interesting things. And when you mentioned about followings, I think he said it was you basically got like a 1% conversion rate, which I would say kind of makes sense. There's one free group that I'm in, that sends stuff out. I think they do okay. And there's like 12,000 people in this channel. I mean, thank God I'm not in there's no group chat. I mean, that would be a nightmare. But I think, every time there's something posted up, there's 12,000 people on that group, and they'll get like, 20 or 30 likes on a post. I mean, I don't even know what that is as a percentage, but it's, it's minuscule. But that's the kind of way it goes. You'll get a few people, who want to interact and do that. And a lot of people kind of sit in the background. You'll have something free, and people again think there's no cost to it. They can pick and choose what they want to get on if they like it or agree with it. Once it becomes something that's paid, there is this kind of it's natural, isn't it? If you're paying for a service, you want to be maximizing it, trying to get on as many bets as possible. So when something's paid, if a price moves fast and people don't get on it, they're going to be annoyed. If again you're making errors and mistakes, a few here or there are understandable, if you're putting a lot of content out. I mean, that's the hope for me, because occasionally I will sort of let's say someone else will point out, I've put something up at a price, someone will find a better price somewhere else. But while it's free, that's great. I can kind of encourage that. The community sort of helps each other out. When it becomes a paid service and you kind of expect your members to do stuff like that, is for me, I find it, I don't know, it could be a bit cheeky, I suppose. Some people could see it as quite cheeky to do that. So, I think that's the problem again, is that there's a lot of tipsters, there's a lot of things out there, and tipsters have a bad reputation. And again, paying for this service, I think this, again, the conversation, this is something in the UK, people don't like to sort of pay for betting advice as much as they do perhaps in the States. I can't, verify that for sure. I don't know how it is in Australia, if they're kind of, there's a similar mentality to the UK, where again, people think, okay, there's plenty of free stuff, why do I need to pay for this? What am I kind of getting out of this? And that's the thing, you could be amazing. You generally will get less pats on the back. than you will sort of abuse long term. Generally, you might have some great winners, and most people won't sort of necessarily congratulate you for it. Well, not that that's what we're after, but it's again kind of par for the course.
Well, I guess it's like expected, isn't it? It's like
exactly. If you're paying for it, that's poor, isn't it?
Yeah. No, it's interesting. Like, I've actually been reasonably lucky in terms of complaints or abuse, whatever you want to call it. I've actually, like, that's one of the things I thought would just, you know, come regularly. And luckily, I don't know, maybe I've just picked a few people that have subscribed are reasonably sharp and they actually understand how this works. I've been very lucky, whereas probably like the last 6 months, probably only had two people, and I would say one of them was like a message that actually I thought was quite rude, whereas the other one was like, oh, it's not really that bad, to be honest. Like, so yeah, I think in my circumstance, I've probably been like 50-50 in terms of like complaints and people saying thank you or whatever. So I've been reasonably lucky in that area. And I mean, maybe, but even that, even though like not many people have complained, it's like, it still does take a massive emotional toll on you when things aren't going well. And it doesn't take someone, I don't know, it doesn't take someone to get angry at me to not get upset at the results, if you get what I mean.
Absolutely.
How have you had any, I mean, it's only been a week, mate, but have you had any complaints or anything, anyone ever crack at you already?
no abuse yet, but this evening as we're recording, I had a clean sweep losers, so a clean sweep of I think seven pre-match bets, which, you know, again, were kind of prepped and researched, but they all lost. And but it's a strange one, because again, I don't necessarily want to sort of, if you go around and you apologize every time you have a bad night, then again, that doesn't inspire confidence, and you shouldn't, because if you are confident in your edge, and again, you know that long term it works and you've done the work, it is just one of those things. But it's human nature. It's impossible really to, you know, unless you're kind of robotic about it, you do feel bad, you know, and you feel frustrated when that happens. So I think it's, you know, it's understandable. So it's kind of finding a balance between, you know, people not thinking that you don't care if you're losing the money, and but at the same time, you know, not being overly apologetic, not trying to, you know, I avoid things. I mean, there's been days where there have been some good winners, and I don't comment on it. You know, I'm not really sort of like, boom, this.
Oh, you fuck know, me sideways, seriously.
This 1.4 shot, you know, five-pointer, you know, boom. No, because that's not me either. So generally it is, you know, again, but then I am someone who generally, I don't tend to watch most of it. I mean, I'm watching football, just the games, just because I enjoy the games, you know, the bets are the bets. I've done the research, I'm happy with the price, but I think, you know, that's an element to it as well. So yeah, generally, you want to kind of do that, and it's very early days on this as well. So it's kind of, you know, it's a week in. So who knows? You know, it could be a bad downturn. There could be, you know, a big upturn. Could be somewhere in between. It could just be sort of ticking along, and I suppose what you want to say, I mean, like, I don't think that many people have left. Let's see tomorrow after tonight's result, you know, and there's kind of a steady stream. But again, because it's free content, generally, you know, people might stick around and see. If it's free, then people might not actually be betting on things, but just watching and kind of seeing how does it turn out. But one thing that's interesting I wanted to ask you as well, because this was, a discussion point, was sort of the importance of sort of the write-ups and the reasoning. So with my approach, because it's kind of a sort of pick and mix, you know, finding EV stuff and the props and everything else, and because of time, I don't put up that many write-ups. There's the odd one where I will, and I kind of want, you know, I want to say something about it, But if I'm putting out kind of 10 bets, I just won't, you know, because I know how long it will take. I'd rather get, you know, as many selections out and do the research, and people trust in the actual bets themselves. Because I know that, you know, you spend a lot of time, really good quality, again, videos and reasoning, and again, kind of, you know, scanning the best prices. You do all that stuff. I don't read any of it, but that's the thing, because I trust you know what you're doing, and because I don't necessarily follow UFC myself, which is different. You know, I imagine, again, subscribers in your group who really love UFC and, you know, really watch it, they're interested to hear your thoughts as a fan. So I guess that's the question for you as well. Like, you know, are the write-ups worth it? Is the reasoning worth it? And then does that give you credibility? Because another thing in the conversation I had again was about, it's not just about ROI. It's not about chasing ROI. It's about gaining credibility. And then, you know, that will come. So the quality of the reasoning is what, you know, should shine through. Whereas my approach to it, again, I don't read a lot of it. I used to when I first started, but now I don't have the time to read through people's reasonings, or because before it was a good learning process to actually understand like how someone might look at the data, how I can look at the data myself and find my own selections. Whereas now it's just, okay, you know, is there a good track record? Does this, you know, do they know what they're doing? Then I'll trust what they say and I'll back it.
Yeah, I think it depends a lot on the sport, to be honest. And because if, you know, for example, like if you're betting on the English Premier League and you're sending me out paragraphs of or a video of why you think Arsenal are going to beat West Ham this weekend, I seriously couldn't give a shit what you have to say. Like, I seriously couldn't give a shit. All I'm going to look at is, all right, you tipped Arsenal at 2.1 in odds. Where did it close at? It closed at 2.2. Did it close at 2.15? In those cases, I don't care what you have to say. The numbers don't lie. You missed something. Unless, you know, you have some special method or something that you don't think the market's factoring in, which, you know, you can, hopefully your tipster's telling you kind of like what their process is, like why they think they have an edge. If they're saying it's data related and you know, they're saying, and they still don't beat the closing line, then I'd be very skeptical. But if they're looking at something else, whatever, I mean, you can go on with this about ages for ages, but if they're tipping it up at 2.1 and it closes 1.95, 1.9, I'm going to be like, I couldn't give a crap what you have to say. You obviously know what you're doing. So, you know, more than happy to follow you. But, I mean, a sport like the UFC, it's not exactly the most efficient market. The money lines are pretty efficient. But in terms of the props, you know, that is not a very efficient market at all. So, I mean, you know, the prices that the sharp bookmakers that they close at are a very good guideline, I would say. Like, most of the time, I think they've got it right. But, you know, the thing is like, I'm not going to follow someone in the UFC MMA space because I trust myself in a way. I for sure, like, I talk to, you know, people like Ryan and other people that I know the sport very well for their opinion on certain fights. You know, that's kind of like my getting reasoning from elsewhere, if you get what I mean. But
is there an advantage though for you, let's say, so for me sometimes, like, you know, it's a similar thing, but I like to get an idea of like the consensus. So
yeah,
what the public are thinking. So for your bets, you know, to just kind of almost anticipate someone's going to be overbet here or underbet because other people are you know, thinking this. You personally, you don't see that from the data that you're looking at. But, I mean, is there an advantage in that sense to sort of to following that?
Yeah, I think being involved in a community that, well, you don't even know. Like, I mean, if say you follow people on Twitter that are bettors too, or say they are, but you don't know anything about these people, do you? They could just be the biggest mugs in the world, and they could just be posting their thoughts after thinking about the fight for 1 minute, whereas I've spent hours. So I'm going to back myself, you know, 100%, you know, 100% of the time, I'm going to back myself more than them that I've done the research or whatever. So I think it's 100%. You should immerse yourself in the community that you're betting in, because a lot of it is bullshit. You just have to kind of pick and choose what you think's noise and what's not. It's very hard to explain, but if you've essentially, what I do is I, you know, spend a couple of hours on a fight, write down all of my thoughts, all of my prices, and then from there I like to go out and listen to other people, podcasts, Twitter, whatever, and see what people have to say. And if they go, oh, I reckon this guy wins because he's an incredible kickboxer or whatever, I'm like, well, I already knew that. But sometimes I'll listen to a podcast and be like, I've seen, you know, someone might say, oh, I've seen photos of this guy cutting weight recently and he looks terrible. So I'm like, well, I didn't factor that in at all, and that's something now I have to think about or whatever. I mean, it happens pretty rarely, but I think it's definitely a valuable thing to immerse yourself. But don't, at the same time, you can't get like, you see someone else tipping the other side and you go, oh, fuck, I've made a mistake here. It's like, well, no, they're just seeing it in a different way, or they could be complete mugs or whatever. So I guess, yeah, summarizing all the reasoning stuff, for me, I if I'm following someone, it's most likely going to be because they are immersed in a sport or very good at a sport that I don't follow, or, you know, don't really know that well. You know, most of the people that I've followed in the past have been soccer related, or I'm trying to golf, stuff like that. Like, I don't, never watched a game of golf in my life, don't know how to play the game. And soccer, I watch basically one game a week, and that's Arsenal. So it's like, I know I'm not an expert. I understand how it works. I understand who's a good football player and who's not, but I don't know the betting space all that well. So I'm not going to even bother listening to your reasoning, because, you know, I can't really critique it at all. Unless they're talking about Arsenal, then I can well and truly critique it.
Yeah, no, I mean, to be honest, that's a fair point. Yeah, it's a really good point. Because again, if you don't feel that confident in the domain, like for me, for like horses, for example, I don't delve into the details. You know, I've just picked up things sort of accidentally along the way, all this knowledge. But at the same time, you know, it's underlying numbers, you know, it's just kind of...
Yeah, racing. That's what you should be trusting more, I think.
Yeah.
The numbers, the closing price.
And trusting in sort of models that other people have built, but again, kind of filtering those with, you know, combinations. So again, when there's kind of big festivals on, it's kind of aggregating, seeing what, you know, what the kind of general consensus is, what the betting public are looking at, what the popular tipsters. I think in a space like racing, again, you know, I mean, people make money just doing that, you know, just waiting for, you know, Hugh Taylor's tips to come out at the races website and just backing on the exchange. I mean, that's what people, you know, because that it has an effect on the prices in the markets. But let's say if you and Ryan have you ever had you know, the fights that you've looked at where both of you have had quite different opinions on? Because generally most of the time I'd imagine you in consensus, but then
I think most of the time we're in consensus, but there's definitely been times where he sent out bets where I've been like, oh, I don't see it that way. And then I think that's I mean, you can bet both sides of a fight and both be correct. I mean, from memory, actually, there was a fight, I think a month or two ago, people probably don't know, it was Grundy versus Amir Khani. And I think I tipped Grundy at like 1.7 or something like that. And he went all the way into 1.4. And by the time that had happened, or like maybe a day before the fight had happened, Ryan had tipped Amir Khani the other side of it at like 3 point, whatever it was. And I was like, it's a good bet. I mean,
it's a good price,
the money had come in too much. I think I priced, I can't remember, maybe 1.5 or something for the other guy. So it's like, Yeah, it pisses me off that you think the other guy's going to win. I mean, it doesn't piss me off, but like, you know, it's like, well, why don't you agree with me? But it, I mean, it's all about prices. So he's getting a good price on that side. I got a good price on the other side. But yeah, I mean, I actually enjoy it when someone doesn't have the same opinion as me, because I want to know why they're thinking differently to me. I really enjoy it. There's you know, fights that are going on this weekend where I've heard people have differing opinions to me. And I don't want to seem like the guy that's like, why are you saying this about this guy? Like, why don't you agree with me? I'm genuinely asking these questions because I want to know what I'm missing, or, you know, why you have a differing opinion to me. So, I actually, on that too, I think if you are investing in people who give you reasoning, a good thing you can do is look at their reasoning and see if there is any point where they give you the con to their bet, the reasoning against their bet. Cause I think that is so key, because people can get so invested in a pick that they don't get blinded by the other side, but they come so biased that they ignore the other side to it. So for people out there that follow tipsters or whatever, see if when they give their reasoning, how they, well, one, if they explain the cons to the bet, or, you know, why it's priced this way, why whatever, if you think someone's favorite, why you think the other side is favorite. Do they even explain, like, do they explain anything? Or, and then secondly, do they explain the it thoroughly, if you get what I mean? Do they just say the reason why this guy's favorite is because he's a good wrestler, I don't really think he is, and then move on? That's not very thorough. Like, try and give a, you know what I mean, like, don't try and see what kind of reasoning they're giving for the other side and why you don't think it's as big as an influence on the odds as you think it is.
No, that's a great point as well. Yeah, because very often, you know, again, when you do have these write-ups, it's kind of, it presents a case. It's kind of presenting something to a jury just kind of sell it. But yeah, there's a reason, you know, if you're backing something that's like, you know, above evens and it's got that, you know, 50-50 chance, there's you know, that the rest of that percentage is doubt, isn't it? There's a reason it's not priced at, you know, 1.01, and but it's worth explaining and just sort of delving into why that's the case. And I don't know how it works, if it's an equivalent in UFC, but things like game state, you know, in football, like the props tonight, you know, that every game, you know, kind of you anticipate, or at least, you know, my process, you anticipate what might happen in a game. But then if it goes against you, you know, then that's kind of potentially disaster for that.
Yeah.
But that's kind of, again, factored in. That's something I definitely need to do more of. I've done the occasional one where I've, you know, expressed, okay, this is what potentially is a risk or this, but it's worth it at the price. I suppose it's kind of assumed that you're kind of only going to list the positives and the reasons for taking it. But definitely, I think it's important to have that balanced view.
Yeah. I was also going to mention, I've recently started reading a book called The Art and Science of Prediction. And it kind of, that's why I said what I said just before was, it was really, it was basically a guy who, and I'm only like a third of the way through the book, but basically a guy who conducted a study over, I think it was like 15 years, where he got all these guys to do predictions on world events, and essentially tried to figure out why certain people were good at predicting future happenings, or who came closest to predicting more right than more wrong. And he said the common, what I've read so far is the common trait between the most successful people was that they, when they wrote their reasoning for their prediction, they wrote both sides of the argument. Whereas the people that failed more or were not as successful only talked about why they were right or why their prediction was right or would be right. So, that's, I mean, if you're a handicapper or, you know, you do your own prices for stuff, I'd highly recommend reading that book is it's been a very interesting learning curve for me so far to see, you know, the art of prediction and who's what kinds of people's analysis has been successful and what's not. So the thing is, mate, there's some good talkers out there. There's some very good, you go and listen to some football podcasts, whatever podcast or shows you watch, there's some bloody good talkers out there and they'll convince you of things that are either irrelevant, factored into the odds already, all these sorts of things. So
And it's a good exercise to do, like next time you do listen to or read something from coming from a tipster or a pundit on TV, you know, again, you know, just are they doing that? Because I suppose in a way, you know, a good example comes to mind of Mark O'Hare. When I listen to him, you know, he does give quite a thorough reasoning and, you know, presents both sides, you know, to what he's saying as well. So it's a good habit to get into, because I can imagine you're creating, you know, a kind of more complex mental model in your head if you're kind of not talking about the, you know, the other potential factors. You know, maybe your pricing isn't as efficient, you know, because let's say if you were to compute all of these thoughts into some kind of model, you know, the best model would have, you know, would take factor in some of that. And yeah, it makes total sense to me. It's a really interesting point.
Yeah. Mate, what do you think? Do you think we should go through this opening new accounts stuff, or do you reckon we've done enough for today? I feel like
we could
potentially save it for another podcast, and we've been going for 50 minutes now.
Sorry, folks, if you were after opening new bookmaker accounts, but we'll leave you in suspense for that one. But you know, for the meantime, you can have a look at sort of priming and stuff. I'll talk about maybe briefly. And I think what we could do maybe, Alex, next time is go into detail. Or we were planning to do a kind of instructional video, so maybe we could kind of put that out there. And it could be a little freebie to something from the course we're working on. But with the opening of new accounts, obviously, a lot of you who are listening to this, I'm sure you've been restricted. I'm sure you've probably asked, you know, your friends and family. You know, if you're like me and you're not the most sociable, you can run out of friends to ask anymore. But let's say, you know, you've got to that stage and you've got a few people left. But I think what I'm really trying to focus on, as well as priming accounts, is how to set them up properly. So again, I've spoken to a few people who are kind of quite smart at doing this and quite tech savvy. And, you know, it's not a case of, you know, going around with like five or six different phones. You know, you can do that, but it's quite kind of cumbersome, and again, it just takes up time sort of doing all of that. So there's ways to do that. So something I've looked into is something called virtual machines. So if that's something, you know, you're interested in, there's lots of kind of tutorials online about how to set up virtual machines. You can do it for free. There is, you know, there is software out there that you can download where you can create this. Well, basically, the bookies are getting smarter. They're, you know, more and more technology on their side, trying to track what you're doing, how you're betting, you know, the kind of patterns in your bets, and again, snooping on your social media. You know, there's a few websites, when you click on them, it sends requests to all this kind of social media platforms out there. So these are kind of things to be aware of. But I think something I've really learned is you need to find ways of hiding in plain sight. So rather than, you know, in the past, and I'm sure maybe people listening to this have done things like using a private browser on your computer, changing your IP address, you know, using a phone and using your data, don't connect to your Wi-Fi. These are kind of basic things when you're opening a new account or you're using a friend's account, you know, you don't want to be using any of your details. So something like a virtual machine is a great way to do this, where it's basically like a computer within your computer. And again, there's ways, you know, of sourcing other IP addresses, or you can connect a virtual machine to your phone connection. And I know this is like some people are probably going to be like just drifting off now.
I think this is a nice little taster, mate, for the next podcast. I think people will be flying back.
So, virtual machines. So the next podcast, maybe I think what we could do, this is the challenge. This is the challenge for me, just teacher dealing with unruly teenagers, you know, a three-year-old toddler. Okay, yeah, that's tough. Life as a professional better, that's tricky. But, you know, the challenge of my life is I'm going to go through this with the world's biggest technophobe, Alex Vella. I'm gonna teach him how to create a virtual machine. If I can teach him, then I can teach anyone. All of you can do it. If he can do it, there's hope for all of us.
I don't even know what a virtual machine is, mate. So this
by
is
by the end of the session, you will. You'll be a master. You'll be an expert at virtual machines.
All right, I love it, mate. No, I think and on the topic of just opening up new accounts, virtual machines as you call them. I think there's, a lot of tips that we can give out too on the next podcast about, priming accounts, which you've gone through a lot already. But kind of other experiences we've had with, the most important bookmaker out there, I guess for most people is probably Bet365. I've experienced some things with them lately, which is really interesting in terms of what creates or what gets you limited and what doesn't. So I think let's save that for another day. I think we can give out some really useful information there, especially surrounding Bet365, because they are, I assume you think the same, they are the best bookmaker to have out there because they've got the most markets there. They probably have the highest limits, I would say, from my experience. I mean, other than obviously sharp bookmakers, but out of all the soft bookmakers,
as an all-round package, it's kind of it's hard to just from ease of use as well. I think, to be honest, even before when I was a mug better, I just liked 365. It's just you could just find your bets quickly, but the whole product generally, it's kind of definitely, and I'm sure everyone out here, it's global, so
exactly
probably most people listen to this. I think so. That would definitely be we could more than happy to focus on them, and
my life would just be so much better if all bookmakers allowed the same limits as Bet365. I know that they're soft and they do limit you, been limited by them many times, but like their limits are far better, at least from what I've experienced, far better than every other soft bookmaker. Like it's not even close for me. It's like probably triple the amount, especially when you open a new account. It's probably triple the, probably more than that. So let's talk about that next time we get you on, mate. As I mentioned on Twitter, I'm going to try and do as, get this podcast back up and running again, do as many episodes as possible, try and do, ideally one a week or maybe one a fortnight would be terrific. Got some guests lined up over the next couple of weeks who will come on, and obviously we'll get Neil on as much as possible. It's good to be back. I feel like 6 months did me well, at least, mate. I feel like I'm refreshed, I'm motivated, at least I'm excited to do some podcasts again. So
we've been missing them, definitely. It's nice, yeah.
And as I've mentioned before, my least favorite part of doing this podcast is finding good new guests. So please, if you have any recommendations, please DM me or anyone that you really want to hear from. You're making my life a lot easier and you'll get more episodes out of it. So you'll make me happier and, it's just a win-win for everyone. But, mate, thanks for coming back on and thanks to everyone for listening. If this is your first time or second time, 20th time on the podcast, and you haven't done a rate and review, please do that. It'd be great to get this out to as many people as possible. And make sure you subscribe. Neil, mate, it's been a pleasure. once again, and I'll see you back very soon.
See you very soon, Alex. Yeah, it's been great to catch up.